Well, thank you. And it's been a long time since I've been up front. So welcome to GCR. Since it's been 4 or 5 months since I taught, and there's a lot of new faces. Just quickly about myself, I am David Tashner. The Lord saved me on October 9th of 2004 during my second separation from my second wife. And by God's grace, Lori's still my wife. And we've been married 23 years this Saturday. So praise God for that. That is God's glory, that he saved us both. And she's put up with me this long. I am a truck driver by trade. I am pitch hitting tonight. So I'm going to be patient with me. That's the way this works. I am also one of our leaders here at GCR, and my wife and I were part of the team that helped build the program. We're very thankful to have a Bible-based program in town. And I think the last thing is I'm a deacon at Saylorville. So that's a little bit about me. Tonight, we're going to be diving into 1 Peter 3. And we're going to start, actually, open your Bibles to 1 Peter 2, because we're going to kind of take the momentum that Kyle gave us last week and roll on in to hope for submissive and suffering servants. And I'm going to pray quick. Father in heaven, I thank you for a chance to share your word, to teach your word, Lord. I pray that you would open hearts, Father. And I just pray that let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So, if you remember, in 1 Peter 1, we were called to be holy, for God is holy. And it says in 1 Peter 1, 23, since you are born again, then. So 1 Peter 1 sets us up for some challenges. And the reason it's setting up for some challenges is because Peter is writing the epistle from, we believe, Rome. In 1 Peter 5, he actually says he's writing for Babylon, but the general understanding is that it is probably another name for Rome. It'd be like calling the United States Babylon. I think we're probably pretty close, truth be told. So Peter is writing, and he's challenging and helping his disciples in his churches suffer and submit. So the goal is to suffer like a Christian. So we go into last week, 1 Peter 2, verses 9 and 10. For you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, now you have. And that's my launch point tonight, is we have, if you are in Christ, you have received mercy. And I understand that maybe not everybody in here is saved tonight. So I hope that I will give you a map to salvation if you're not. So to suffer like a Christian is to create a contrast with the world around us. And creating a contrast with the world around us when we suffer well leads us to evangelism. Some of the best evangelistic opportunities I've had is when I've been under pressure or persecuted, not necessarily for my faith, but sometimes for my faith. And how we respond to that changes the world. When I go to work and I'm a truck driver and the other guys come around, I don't walk in there and say, hey guys, I'm a Christian, let me tell you about Jesus. I walk in, and I've been told by multiple men, David, there's just something about you that I just don't feel comfortable swearing around you. Not everybody, but there's a lot of people that there's something different, and I don't know what that is, other than to say the Holy Spirit. So that's where we're going tonight. We're going to hopefully give you application to live like a Christian, to act like a Christian. So to begin with, I'm going to show you some pictures of some people that have suffered well. They submitted and they suffered well. This is a picture of Joseph. You might have the one with a Technicolor dream coat if you are into Hollywood or plays. But he had 11 brothers, and he spent most of his adult life either in prison or in slavery, and he rocked it. He absolutely made it look good, because whenever he was in prison, he was brought to the top and served as one of the leaders under the prison warden. He also became a leader under Pharaoh and was the second in command of Egypt at one point in time, which allowed him to bring his 11 brothers, his father Jacob, one of our patriarchs, into the promised land so they could be protected from a 7-year famine and multiply greatly, to eventually Moses would have the privilege of leading them across the Red Sea and out of Egypt. The next is Esther. We're going to talk about Esther a little bit more. But Esther was placed in a situation where she had, first, she lost her parents. She was adopted by her uncle Mordecai, which is suffering. Then she was plucked out of the virgins of of Babylon at that time, true Babylon now, in Arabia. She was plucked as a beautiful woman and taken into the king's harem. She didn't have any choice. If you were beautiful and you were virgin, you were taken into slavery. But God protected her, and she was faithful because she quickly went to the top of the harem because the way she responded and acted, she acted like a Christian. And the last one is, not the last one, the second to last one is one that you might have seen if you were at Saylorville Church on Sunday. This is Daniel. And the special thing about Daniel is he was in the lion's den. He was probably made into a eunuch and taken into slavery as a young man. And he was faithful. And he essentially became second in command in Babylon. So again, faithful doesn't always mean we get what we want. He's in slavery. He's a eunuch. But you can see in the lion's den, which most of you have heard of the story of Daniel in the lion's den, this picture shows what he's doing. He's looking up to God. He's seeking first the kingdom of God. And the reason this picture is so important to me is because of this man, Charles Stanley, who died just a couple of weeks ago at age of 90. The reason Charles Stanley is important to me is because my wife was saved under his TV teaching at about when he was about 70 years old. And so he's a special man in our lives. But the reason that that picture of Daniel was so special is because it changed his life when he was about 30 and set him on a trajectory of ministry and not looking back. And if you have been raised with Christ, set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. That's our goal. And the last is our Lord Jesus Christ. And I would say every second of the time he spent on this earth in a human body, in one of these weak tents, he was suffering because he had to leave the side of the Father. And he became a man through Mary and the Holy Spirit. And he suffered. The last 3 years of his life were his primary ministry. And those ended with incredible bloodshed and a death on the cross, completely sacrificial death on the cross for our sins. So if we would repent and believe, we would be saved. And he was obedient in doing this. And the Father saw this, the Father in heaven saw this, and he raised him back to life, proving that Christ was obedient in what he did. He's calling us to do the same. So what does a submissive servant look like? I've already given you some examples. I think most of us have seen these examples before. Let's go into 1 Peter 2:18 now. And I'm going to read 1 Peter 2:18 through 25, which says, "Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the unjust. For this is a gracious thing. When mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it when you sin and are beaten for it? You endure. But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued to entrust himself to him who judges justly. Verse 24, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your soul. So let's go to verse 18. Servants, be subject to your masters. In Christ, if you are in Christ, you are a servant. I'm a servant up here. My natural tendency might be at home watching YouTube or fixing my truck or something like that, but I want to be obedient. And so I'm here serving. You're here tonight serving in a way, serving being next to your neighbor, encouraging people in the room just by having a full room. And you're serving by watching the video. I thank you for that as well. Verse 19, we want to be mindful of God in all that we do. For this is a gracious thing when mindful of God, one endures sorrows while suffering. So, been sick for a while? I know there's people watching that have been sick for years. And they're still looking to the Lord Jesus. And they're still praying. And some are praying for me tonight. How are you suffering? Are you suffering well? Verse 20 says, for what credit is it if you, when you sin and are beaten for it, you endure? Okay, so this is gospel-centered recovery. Many of us in here, not all, many of us in here have either gambled our lives away, drank, drugged, porn, horrible idolatry, oftentimes brings us into this room. Sometimes shopping, sometimes gossip. We suffered for those sins. I definitely suffered for my sin of temper. I suffered a divorce from my first wife because of my temper. I was in the church the whole time. And I'm divorced because of my temper. My wife asked me to leave twice. Same reason, my temper. I spent 6 years working on myself, trying to fix myself. I couldn't do it. I didn't have the power to do it. By God's grace, Christ saved her. A year and a half later, Christ saved me, and we learned how to forgive. We learned how to have mercy, because Christ has given us mercy. So that's suffering for our sin. But how about suffering for doing what's right? How about not signing the agreement at work that you will toe the party line at work? How about not lying on the test that you might lose your job with? These are the times when the rubber meets the road in our lives and where we might suffer for Christ's sake because the company or whatever doesn't agree with our angle. It's going on today. So if we suffer well, 1 Peter 5:4 says, there is an unfading crown of glory awaiting for us. So we have something to fight for. We actually have an unfading crown of glory that's awaiting us in heaven if we suffer well. Just one more reason to suffer well, but I really think Christ is enough. So what does this look like? Verse 21, for to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving us an example so that we might follow in his steps. Christ's death on the cross is an example for us of how to live and how to suffer well. Verse 22. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he continued entrusting himself to him who judges righteously or justly. Jesus trusted his heavenly Father, showing us that we can trust our heavenly Father if we are in Christ. I mean, we can trust him with our lives. I think for the sake of time, I'm going to move on to 1 Peter 3. So we're going to see a little bit different form of suffering here as we start 1 Peter 3. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, as 1 Peter 3:1, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Ladies, this is a challenge taken along with Ephesians 5:21 through 24, which says, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church. I know this is not popular in our day. I know the feminist movement has erased the true meaning of what this is talking about. But what this is essentially, not essentially, what this is for is so that you can win your wicked husband to Christ. Amen. Or in the case of my wife, that's what she did. Never mind. That's what your behavior did, honey. I don't want to discount your godliness during those trials in our early part of our marriage. We were separated for 2 years in the first 5 years of our marriage. We went through two anniversaries separated. And so, by God's grace, I thank the Lord that I get to sleep in the big bed. I really do. Do not be adorned. Now it's talking about physical appearance. Do not let your adorning be external. The braiding of hair, the putting on of gold jewelry, or the clothing you wear. But let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. One of the things I know Lori teaches her ladies is let your clothing adorn your face. Let your clothing guide your face. If your clothing is guiding to somewhere else, ladies, it's guiding to sensuality. It's guiding to a man who's going to search and find you for the wrong reasons. So this is there to help you find a godly husband, which is very hard to find nowadays, right, Lisa? For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves by submitting to their own husbands. As Sarah, verse 6, obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. So this is very difficult for a wife with an angry husband like me, or a husband who's addicted to drugs and alcohol and changes his whole personality for days or weeks at a time because of a chemical in his body. Don't get me wrong, you do not have to put up with physical damage. We have laws at the church. We will support you. We will protect you at Saylorville Church and any of our engaged churches. And we will help you call the law enforcement if necessary, if that's going on in your home, and make sure you're safe and protected. With that said, ladies, you have a high calling. But men, as I look at the next verses, likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor the woman as a weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. For the most part, women have a weaker body structure. Can't do as many pull-ups. How about that? And what that means is we have a responsibility of looking at them with love and adoration. And the reason we have that responsibility, guys, and not looking at a woman who walks in scantily clad, not looking at the magazine or the commercial that comes into your house, but we look at our wives, we look at women as the image of God, who are made in the image of God, as bearers of souls made by God. Image bearers, that's the word I was looking for, image bearers of God. So Ephesians 5, I already suggested Ephesians 5, 22 through 24 is to the let ladies submit. Ephesians 5, 25 says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Single guys, love the women coming in and out of your life as Christ loves the church. Okay? Christ loves us perfectly. That's where husbands, men, we get the call to love. Okay? We look at our risen Savior and how he loved us, if we're in Christ, how he truly loved us and changed us. And then we look at our wives the same way. Some of the hints that I've learned, if you're angry at your wife, look at her the way when you met her. Look at her with the beauty that she had when you met and you were goo-goo eyes. It changes your heart. I cannot tell you how important it is to me, men, how important it is to Christ that you're loving your wives sacrificially, that you're laying your life down for your wife like Christ laid down his life for you. This is very difficult for some of us because I know some of us in here are separated from our wives. And I feel your pain. I really do. And I cannot tell you if your wife's going to come back or not. I can't promise that to you. But I can tell you the Lord will keep you when you're separated. The Lord is enough for you to hold on to during this horrific trial that you're going through. So we pray, and I pray, that your wives will return to you. But if they don't, please keep looking up. As the man that led me to the Lord said, keep looking up, keep looking up. Christ can give us strength. David said in Psalm 86:16, give your strength to your servant. So I pray for the Lord to give you strength during this trial. So we're going to move from that very heavy topic of submission, and I apologize, that is a very heavy topic of submitting, into suffering. Ooh, how about that? This just gets better and better and better. So what does suffering look like? I'm going to go to verse 8. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, so that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever would seek to love life, this is Psalm 34, verses 12 through 14, I think. For whoever would seek to love life and see good days, let him keep himself from evil. GCR, let us keep ourselves from evil. Let us keep our lips from speaking deceit. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to the prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, we've got a list here, and I apologize. I've got to get these back in order. We've got a list here of five things. Unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. I'd take a picture of that if I were you, because one of our questions tonight in our small groups is going to be on that specific. I'm not going to get into each one of those verses, but if you're going to be a group leader, grab a picture of that while I talk. Basically, unity of mind means we are united with our brothers and sisters in Christ. We do not try to cause division. Sympathy, you know, I pointed to my eyes because sympathy means we see somebody who's hurting and we have compassion and love for them. It's a to-do thing. I have sympathy for you, so I'm going to care for you. I'm going to bring a meal for you. I'm going to spend hours talking with you, driving you somewhere. That's sympathy. Brotherly love, that ties right into brotherly love. We love our brothers and sisters in Christ many times more than we love our own family members who are not saved. Is this true? GCR, is this true? Have you experienced that? Yeah. Yeah, it's true. So let me continue. Verse 13. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. There's a blessing. There's good news if we suffer for righteousness' sake. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy. Let me go back. And verse 14, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will. I think that's vitally important. This is not a name it and claim it, I get what I want. God does lead us into suffering. Christ is the best example of what that looks like. He was perfect, and yet he died on the cross for something he never did. He died for our sins, so that we could become the righteousness of God in him. So I've already said verse 14, there's a promised blessing in there. Verse 15, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being ready to give an answer. We need to be ready for evangelism. We need to be ready to share Christ with people. If our behavior is good, a little side note, I think it'll actually lighten things up a little bit. I, after I was saved, thought it was cool and good evangelism to occasionally throw a cuss word in there. Now, I was the kind of person that even when I was actively partying, doing all the wrong directions, my friends actually said, David, it doesn't sound right when you swear. I wasn't saved, but for some reason, I couldn't even swear right. So I didn't know why. I didn't know why I thought that I could throw a cuss word in there to help, you know, with my Christian integrity. Lori and I were driving. We were heading toward the eastbound, the East Mixmaster in Des Moines. And she said, David, how do you think you have more integrity if you're breaking God's commandments? And I thought, oh, wow, you know? And I did not get mad at her for saying that. She was my helper, and it changed my behavior. And I stopped cussing for the sake of winning friends, because I think that's really all it was about. I thought, if I could make you as a friend, then maybe I'd get to share Christ with you. Uh-uh. No. If you don't see Christ in me, you're not going to listen to my words, right? So, anyway, the takeaway from that is, let it go. If you've got sin, kind of like Kyle shared last week, I thought it was possible. You know, I thought it was powerful. There was a ton of sin up here that he'd let go of after he was saved. But there was still that little sin he was holding on to. Gospel-centered recovery. Flee. The verse goes, flee sexual immorality. But I say, flee sin. Cut your arm off if it sins against you. Take your eye out. Now, don't literally do that. My uncle was a doctor in Kentucky, and there was actually stories where he was in the emergency room and people had done that. Don't do that. Change your behavior. Look to Christ. And as Kyle said so well, he will change your behavior. I'm an example of that. For 6 years, I tried to change my own behavior and I couldn't. God saved me and he started changing me. And the best, my wife sitting in this room is the best proof of that's true. But my wife has told me that too. And yes, I still have things. I just had to repent to Lori on Sunday morning for something I did on Saturday afternoon. Okay? So it's not perfect. But it's growing. And it's repenting. And that's the goal. Is we begin, we repent to Jesus, ask him forgiveness, and we're saved. After we're saved, we repent and we reunite with our brother or sister that we sinned against. And God. Isaiah 59, 1 and 2 says, the Lord's hand is not so short that it cannot save, nor is ear dull that it cannot hear. But your sin, your iniquity has separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face so that he cannot hear you. Let's go down to, I'm going to read through 18. I think that's where I stopped. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Galatians 2:20 is what came to mind. We have been crucified with Christ. I've been crucified with Christ. So I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. If you weren't here when Pastor Pat taught a year and a half or so ago, Christ lives in me. Christ lives in you. The life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me, who loved you, and gave himself for me and you. This is a perfect gift that you can receive. We get into some difficult verses here, verse 19, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is 8 persons, were brought safely through water. Now baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you. What? Okay, let me keep reading. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with the angels and authorities and powers, having been subjected to him. So, all creation is subject to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ now. But what does this, what's this, all this about? Noah's Ark and baptism and stuff. First, I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to try to just draw a quick picture for you. Pastor John MacArthur says, Peter is teaching the fact that 8 people were in the ark and went through the whole judgment and yet were unharmed. And it's analogous to the Christian's experience in salvation by being in Christ, who is the ark of our salvation. The resurrection shows that God accepted Christ's obedience and sacrificial death. So what we have here, when we see Noah's Ark, and this is, if you ever have a chance, a little commercial, if you ever have a chance to go to the Ark Encounter, south of Cincinnati, Ohio, this is just a hint, this is what you're going to see. I'm not going to show you the insides. It's a full-scale model of Noah's Ark, built to the best model that they could understand with science from that time. So, Noah and his wife were kept in a boat, in an ark, and carried through, I believe it was 120 days of flood. And along with their 3 kids and the spouses, their 3 boys and the wives of their 3 boys, everybody else in the world was judged, was destroyed. So what that that is verse 20. Verse 21, baptism which now corresponds to that, this now. So what we're talking about is something called an antitype. So in this case, the ark represents Jesus' body. The blood is a type of the water. So the water to the blood, I think I mixed that up. The water on the ark represents the blood of Jesus. The ark represents Jesus' body. Jesus' body, which the ark held the eight people in Noah's family. So what this is saying is that, and Peter even clarifies here, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. When we are in Christ, Colossians 3, verses 4 and 5, and I need to start with verse 1 again because I can't remember it off. Can't remember 3 without getting to 1. So if you, so forgive me, bear with me. If you have been raised with Christ, set your mind on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. Set your heart on things above, not on earthly things. And here's the ark. For you have died, and your life is hidden in Christ with God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then we will also appear with him in glory. So salvation puts us in Christ. Jesus said in John 10, 27 through 30, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they answer me. Jesus knows his sheep, and I give them eternal life. And they shall never perish, neither shall anyone pluck them out of my hands. My Father, who is greater than all, has given them to me. And nobody will pluck them out of my Father's hands. We got Jesus, we got the Father. And then he says, my Father and I are one. So Christ is calling you to live as one of his sheep, obediently. And very quickly, I'm going to close by going to 1 Peter 4, 1 and 2. Jim, I promise I'm not going any further into James because I need to wrap up for time's sake. But it says, 1 Peter 4, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. Be willing to suffer in the flesh. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for our human flesh, our human passion, our human desires, but for the will of God. So, Gospel Center Recovery, GCR at Saylorville, this is our challenge. I challenge you to live for the will of God. Repent and put your faith in Christ. And then live like you are in Christ, because you are. I'm going to pray. Father, thank you so much for giving us your word, for showing us how to suffer, Lord. It's so difficult. Lord, we don't want to suffer. We truly don't want to, but you do call us to suffer for righteousness' sake. You say it's part of your will. So for those of in here, Lord, who are actively suffering right now, Father, be merciful, be gracious. Lord, restore marriages. Please restore sobriety, restore friendships, restore relationships. Lord, will you save that your mercy can shine? And that, Father, we can share your word and win others for your sake. Father, thank you for all those in here you've called to be sheep. We love you, Good Shepherd. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.